So hello, my name is Louis. I'm a math student and a computer science enthusiast. I've been doing Google Summer of Code for 2 years, well, last year and now this year, for Boost. And today we'll be talking about metaprogramming. In particular, I'll present a new way of metaprogramming in C++. And as you can see, the title is pretty bold. I claim it is a paradigm shift. I claim this new way of doing metaprogramming is actually the future. I'll try to convince you of that. So first off, I'd like to locate the paradigm shift and what I'm going to present amongst the different ways of doing computations in C++, right? Because there are many ways of doing many types of computations in C++. So first, we have runtime computations, classic computations, basically, right? And in this quadrant, we have runtime sequences, like std vector. They are homogeneous sequences, right? Like a vector, it only contains objects of the same type, of a single type. Then we have runtime functions, normal functions, right? Homogeneous functions too, because their return type and their argument types are fixed. And when we mix those together, we can get runtime algorithms, which basically take sequences or more generally structures, right? Runtime structures and runtime functions, and then transform them. So nothing new here. Now, since C++ 11, we can do constexpr computations, okay? Computations at compile time. So in this world, what we have is constexpr sequences. A constexpr sequence is basically a sequence whose implementation is compiler friendly, sort of, right? It's friendly enough that the compiler is able to evaluate it at compile time. Okay, so for example, the implementation doesn't must not throw, it must not allocate memory and stuff like that. And then we have constexpr functions. Again, homogeneous constexpr functions, right? And it was homogeneous constexpr sequences. So homogeneous constexpr functions are basically functions that are friendly enough to the compiler that he's able to evaluate them at compile time. When we mix those together, we can get constexpr algorithms. So it wouldn't, like, it's not implemented here, but it wouldn't be really hard to implement a constexpr transform, which takes a function and applies it to every element in an array, and then returns the resulting array. And as long as you have a constexpr sequence, and as long as you have a constexpr function, then the result of this algorithm here can be constexpr too, right? The third quadrant is comprised of heterogeneous computations. What are these guys? Has anybody used the Boost Fusion library before? Okay, good. Really good. Basically, in this world, we have heterogeneous sequences. Okay. For example, a fusion vector. It's basically a std tuple. It's basically that, except it has more algorithms that you can use to transform it. Okay. But it's really basically a std tuple. So a heterogeneous sequence is simply a sequence where the elements may have different types. They do not need to, but they may. Then we have heterogeneous functions. Basically, a heterogeneous function is just a fancy name for a template function. And oh yeah, I just like to point out that I'm using a function object, but it's just because my slides, I want them to compile. Okay, so because of the next slide. But so basically, heterogeneous functions are simply templates. They have a argument type and a return type that may be dependent on. That may differ from one invocation to the other. And when we mix those, we can get heterogeneous algorithms. So for example, Fusion has this algorithm called transform, which takes a heterogeneous sequence, a heterogeneous function, and simply applies it to each element in the sequence and returns a fusion vector with the result. Okay. And this is useful to do a bunch of stuff, like, but of course it's for metaprogramming, but for example, Spirit uses a lot of heterogeneous sequences like that, and it's useful for creating domain-specific languages and other applications. And then we have the fourth quadrant, type-level computations. Who has used the MPL? Okay. Sorry?
Indirectly.
Indirectly, okay. Type-level computations, okay. In this world, we have type-level sequences. Basically, we're talking about sequences that contain types, okay? And usually, they're implemented as templates, those sequences, okay? Then we have type-level functions that we also, oh, it's not highlighting properly. Okay, that's weird. So we have type-level functions, which we also call meta-functions, right? And we have, since C++ 11, we have the type threats in the standard, which are examples of meta-functions. And yeah, so here, when we're doing type-level computations, we really consider the types to be like our objects, right? And the meta-functions to be our functions. And then when we mix those together, we get type-level algorithms. So for example, here, I create a MPL vector with some types in it, and then I just apply the MPL transform algorithm with this meta-function here, and simply the meta-function will be called, will be applied to each element in the sequence, and so I'm going to get a vector of int star, char star, so on. Actually, int const char. Int const putter and so on. And I'd like to note that fusion vector is not the same as MPL vector. Some people tend to confuse them. The thing is, if I have an MPL vector, I can put any types I want in it. But if I have a fusion vector, I expect to be able to hold the value of that type. So for example, if I try to put void in it, or something, an incomplete type, or anything which has no, for which you cannot create a value of that type, well, then you're finished, right? Compiler error. And now, here's the subject of this talk. Here's my claim. My claim, which might seem to be a bit contradictory with the previous slide, is that I have trouble with my slides. No, my claim is that type-level computations are indeed nothing but heterogeneous computations. Or more precisely, it is possible to take any type-level computation and to represent it as a heterogeneous computation. Okay, and of course, the benefit of doing so is not clear immediately, and I will show it to you. But seriously, why bother with this whole construction, and why not just continue using the MPL and fusion? I mean, they do the job. We're kind of happy with them. Well, it turns out that C++ 14 is a very serious game changer. It's now possible to do much better in terms of metaprogramming that we could do before. Some of the features that we really use are auto-deduce return type. This makes a huge difference when you try to implement algorithms on heterogeneous sequences. Also, generic lambdas are really, really nice for metaprogramming, as I'll show you. And variable templates, they provide some nice syntactic sugar. But of course, nothing is better than seeing for yourself. So here we go. Here's how we use to check for a member. Oh, this is annoying, really. Should be syntax highlighted. God, I get problems with my computer. Okay.
Can you stand up there and advance slides for you?
What? No, the problem is just it should be syntax highlighted. Can you give me your computer for a sec? Excuse me? Yeah, no, the problem is just like syntax highlighting for the code. You see it's all white.
Does it look right here or not?
Yeah, it does. Not sure why.
Oh,
okay, wait, just Oh, do I see full screen on here? Maybe, I don't know. Is it better?
No.
Ah, good. Okay, what do we do? Okay, let's go ahead. Okay, sorry guys. I know, the problem is my computer is complete crap and I have no Wi-Fi. So actually, what you can do is, okay, ldn.com, thank you. Won't be long. Oh, hey, how do I plug that? Okay. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Hey, that's so not what I want. No, no, no. It's okay. Just, I just want to go to that URL. Is this like a? Oh, okay. I forgot that. Sorry, guys. There you go. Okay, should be better. And now let's replug this again. Gonna need to install this. Dang. What did I do?
Just close the window.
No, but it's not going to work then. Think.
It'll work.
Sure. No, it doesn't. Sorry? Oh, God. Okay, good. Now, here we go. Okay. Let's not lose our time anymore.
Colors.
We got colors.
Okay. Woo. Take two, huh? Okay, so where are we? There, and claim, and then that, and see for yourself. There we go. Okay, so this is how we use to check for a member, right? So here, what I want to do is write some kind of function or meta function, which, given a type t, I'd like to know whether it has a member named xxx. And now I'm going to use, you know, like the classic Sfine hacky tricks to do that. And I'm not going to explain the snippet because I guess like everybody here probably knows basically how it works. Now, soon, with the introduction of std void t, which I think will be in 17, but I could be wrong. It's possible to, as you can see, to reduce slightly the size of this hack, right? But it is still a hack. It's still, if you show this to your coworkers, they're still going to be like, what the hell is going on? Like, you have to know what is Sfine, right? And not everybody knows that. Or should know that. And what is, I think it should be like that. I think it should be no more complicated than just like saying, okay, so is it valid or not? Like, can I have this t.xxx? Is it valid to do that? Okay? And actually, this works. One liner, yeah. Yes, so the comment is, since I'm taking by value here in the function, it implies that the type is copy constructible. It's true. I could use just an R value reference, but it wouldn't fit in the slide. Okay. Now, here's how we did introspection. Okay. So basically, here, what I want to do is, given a user-defined struct, I want to see that struct. I want a programmatic interface to that struct, okay? And I want to see that struct as a map, a compile time map, where the keys are some types, and the values associated to those keys are the members of the struct. So this way, I'm able to say like, hey, what is the member, the value associated to the name key, which represents basically the name member in John, okay? And to do that, I just used some macro from Fusion, which takes care of some boilerplate, and I can do that. And now here's what's possible with C++ 14. So yeah, right, doesn't look like much better, right? But there's actually a very nice difference. And the difference is that instead of having to associate types to the members of my structure, I'm now using compile time strings. So I do not need anymore to declare these dumb types and then to use a clunky syntax at key, you know, with the angly brackets. I do not need to use that clunky syntax anymore. It is more natural. I can use compile time strings instead. And okay, this is ugly. I do agree, it is really ugly. It would be possible to do better if we had proper user-defined literals. Basically, we could write like age underscore s, and it would do the same, which is pretty nice. Might try to write a paper for that. But so for now, we're stuck with that. But it's still an improvement, right? You don't have to keep the keys in sync with the rest of the code. Generating JSON, nope. Not going to do it with Fusion and MPL. However, so given our same person struct, which is now adapted with this like library, with some library, right? What I'd like is for toJSON to create a string, which I can now see out, and this should be the output. Okay? Like, pretty simple. So first, we're going to handle base types. So yeah, helper function, helping to help code stuff. And then if you have a stud to string, if I can call stud to string on you, then I do it. And otherwise, if you're a char or a stud string, just quote it for the purpose of JSON, right? Now handle sequences. So this overload is enabled when XS is a sequence. And basically what I do here is I take my sequence, I transform it using this lambda here, okay, and I simply generate the JSON for each member, for each element of the sequence. Okay, everybody's following? Yeah.
Is this transform a std transform or is it Hanna transform?
This is Hanna transform. So okay, the question was, is this std transform or some other transform? And it's some other transform. This could be a tuple, okay? And then simply what I'm gonna do is take my JSON and then join it using commas and finally have the little square brackets on each side. And then I wanna handle user-defined types. So what I'm going to do is, this overload is only enabled when I receive some user-defined type. And what I'm going to do is take the keys, which the keys of my user-defined type. This returns a tuple of compile time strings, and then I transform this tuple of compile time strings. So here I get, so name is going to be some compile time string, okay, for each key, key in the user-defined struct, and then I fetch the member associated to that key, and then I quote it. I take the JSON, the member, transform it to JSON, and then just put a column in between, and then again I join the whole JSON with a comma and it does the trick. So that's it. I think it's pretty simple, and it's pretty natural. It looks like normal C++, but we're like iterating on tuples. And if you're still not convinced that we can do better, I got a bit more. So error messages. Say I want to reverse a MPL sequence, and then for some reason, because I'm deep in some template code, I don't realize it, but I actually call it with some like a integral constant from the MPL. Well, what happens is, implicit instantiation of undefined template, boost MPL, clear impl. What the hell, right? You really have to know the implementation of the MPL to understand that that's your problem, actually. And of course, there is a bunch of spew. And now, static assert, right? C++ 11, And just by being a bit careful, you get an error message that at least kind of, you know, gives you a hint as to what the problem is. And then, well, points to the error here. So it's not to say that annoying error messages are completely gone in with C++ 14, but we can now do much better still. Compile times. So anybody who has done even just a bit of metaprogramming knows that compile times are really, really a pain, right? You always end up with like translation units that take a minute or more. It's annoying, really annoying. Okay, this chart shows the time required just to include different metaprogramming libraries. So here's some modern metaprogramming library. This is the MPL and this is Fusion. This is the time for including the whole library. And as you can see, by using modern techniques, we're able to cut down the include time. This is mostly because we didn't have to emulate variadic templates through preprocessor hacks. This is mostly why. And so it also makes the implementation much easier and much shorter. And it also means that when you get a compiler crash inside this library, you have more chances to understand what's going on than if you crash somewhere in the MPL. You're going to be like, what is that, right? And here's a chart showing the compile time performance of an algorithm, the transform algorithm here. And so this is for Fusion. It's pretty bad. And it stops at 50, because you cannot create a Fusion vector with more than 50 elements. And then here's for the MPL. So it starts here and then grows up like that. And finally, here's two different, slightly different benchmarks with a modern metaprogramming library. So as you can see, the complexity is much better. And so you might be wondering, hey, but you know, the MPL for maybe under 10 elements is actually better than the modern metaprogramming library. Well, the thing is, when you include MPL vector, it only includes like MPL vector and nothing else, no algorithms. Whereas in this metaprogramming library, when you include a tuple, it also includes all the algorithms that you can do with the tuple. So the difference is that with MPL, you always end up writing like 13 or 15 includes just to use basic functionality, whereas only one include is required here. But of course, in a test like that, you know, which is a micro benchmark, where I only included like the minimum, so the initial cost of including just that file is lower for the MPL. So in actual code, you would end up including a lot of MPL files, and that curve would be shifted like that. So my claim is that we must rethink metaprogramming. I think we do. But how shall we do that? Here's how I think we should do it. This pointer is... So first, let's ask us a question. What is an integral constant? Like a std integral constant or an MPL integral constant. There are many ways to see an integral constant. First, we can see an integral constant as a type-level encoding of a compile-time entity, right? It's just a type-level representation of a constexpr value of an integral type. Another way to see a integral constant is as a constexpr preserving container. And this is the way I want to look at things. So what happens here is we have this function f, which try to static assert that its argument is equal to 1. And then we have this constexpr int 1, which is constexpr, of course. And then we pass it to f. And the compiler says, hey, t is not constexpr. You can't do that. You cannot static assert on t because it is not a constant expression. Surely it is a constant expression, right? The way to picture this is, consider what happens is if f is defined in a different translation unit. How can the compiler, when it compiles this function in a different translation unit, how can it know that it was called with a constant expression? It cannot. And so argument passing strips away contextpreness, the quality of being contextpre. So the fix for that is, instead, we're going to take our contextpre value, hide it into an integral constant. Okay. The result here is that our value is actually represented inside this type. And when we call f with that, t is deduced to be an integral constant int 1. And since integral constant has a contextpre conversion, a implicit contextpre conversion to int, t gets contextpre converted to int 1, and then we do the equal, we compare it with 1, and everything is contextpre. Is everybody following? Yes. Excuse me. What?
Does the fact that integral constant is a template, is that the thing that strips, that can maintain its contextpreness?
So the question is is, because integral constant is a template, the reason why it can preserve its contextpreness? The reason the answer is this, is that your question? The answer is that t is no more contextpre in this case than in this case. Okay, t is not a is never a constant expression, even in this call. However, we take a non-constant expression t, and from it we convert it. We implicitly convert it, and this conversion is constexpr. So we implicitly convert it at compile time to 1. Get it? Good. Great. Yes.
So you said like f is in a different translation unit. Since it's a template, it'll be in the same translation unit, and you can see that the t is a t constexpr, right, in the first call.
Okay. Then, so the comment is, since f is a template, it has to be in the same translation unit. That's true. However, consider the instantiation of, not the instantiation, but like, yeah, the instantiation of the template for t. You know, so you could like, f here is just basically saying, when we call f, it's like saying like f of int and then thing, right? So just picture yourself if f of int was defined in a different translation unit. You know, it's really just.
So the constexpr is not part of the type t. Is that what it is?
Yes, exactly. So the comment is that constexpr is not part of the type t. No, it isn't, right? For those who were at Scott's talk on constexpr, he clearly said that you cannot write like constexpr t here. It's not possible. Okay?
If 1, instead of constexpr, you said enum raise 1 equal 1, would the first call work?
Enum 1.
Instead of using a constexpr int, you make it an enum.
So the question is, if I use an enum instead, would it work? No, it wouldn't, because you would still be passing the value of the enum, right, as an argument here. And inside of f here, we would be left with an enum, which is not constexpr, an enum value, which is not constexpr. Everybody following? So this is really tricky, actually. And OK, so we can do constexpr arithmetic, basically just normal arithmetic, right? And we can do the same with integral constants, but it's a bit hairy. So basically, we use a meta function, and then we do type level computations with these. Okay. What if we actually looked at our integral constants as if they were objects? Then it might make sense to define operators on the integral constants. Why not? And then we would return the results. Like here, I'm not resulting a bool. I'm returning an integral constant, right? Holding the result. And then it would suffice to value initialize integral constants and to use operators instead of having this clunky syntax that we saw earlier. I mean, that would be equivalent, right? So what happens here, basically, is I have an integral constant in 1, integral constant in 4, and it's going to call this here, and it's going to return an integral constant int 5. And so then I'm left with a value initialized object of type integral constant in 5, and then I equal it with here with this, and this will return an integral constant bool true, which I can then decal type and fetch the nested value in it. So the question is, why is the decal type necessary? It isn't. I just wanted everybody to understand that we're actually doing type-level computations with value syntax. But it is really type-level computations. I'm returning an integral constant here, not a Boolean integral constant, not a Boolean. And this is the key. There. And then we can use variable templates to get some sugar. So int underscore is just equivalent to a value initialized integral constant int something. And then it suffices to just write this, which is kind of neat, I think. It's much better than what we had at the beginning, right? With the like plus and then colon type and stuff like that. And even if you used alias templates, template aliases actually, for the first solution, it would still be hairy, yes. Yes. So the comment is that in this example, it's not really useful because we could just, you know, have like 1 plus 4 equals 5, and it would be equivalent. It's true that this example is not useful, but the goal is to pass these into functions and to achieve, for example, to pass this to a function, and then, for example, to use this result as an array bound. Well, no, it's a Boolean, so not really, but you get it. Or as an array bound or in a static assert or something like that. Anything that requires a constant expression. So we're hiding these values inside types to preserve constexpressiveness through function calls. And more sugar, we have user-defined literals. So we're able, using user-defined literals, to parse these, you know, these literals at compile times and to create the proper integral constant. And this actually works. So we went from like this huge hairy to this pretty nice looking and like natural looking thing, which I think everybody in this room can understand without having to use like weird conventions of colon type and stuff like that and meta functions. So we really have a gain in readability here. Okay, here's a small example. I'm going to compute the Euclidean distance of in the 2D plane at compile time. So first, with the classic approach, I'm not showing square root. So that's it. You know, it's just like nothing to say about that. I think it's crap. Really, and you know, so we could use then template aliases, but still we would be left with like clunky syntax with angly brackets, not really flexible. Well, okay, yeah, not really flexible, not really understandable from at first sight. Okay, and not reusable. Now we can just write that because we have compile time arithmetic with value syntax. And so here's what happens. I create a point. It has the point, of course, you can picture this as point is basically equivalent to std make pair. It has to be able to have two elements with different types, right? Because I'm passing it integral constants. So that's important. And so when you get that, I have a point which is comprised of integral constants. And then I compute the distance. So this is an integral constant, this is an integral constant, and these are two. And so this is an integral constant here, integral constant, all the way. And then square root returns an integral constant. And square root can just be written naturally too, in the same way. Yes.
In that particular case, you could do all the computations at compile time.
Consexpr, right?
Consexpr.
Yes. Okay. So the comment is, in that particular case, I could do the computation using homogeneous consexpr computations, and then basically compute the distance with consexpr using 3, 5, 7, and 2, no integral constant, and then just put the result into an integral constant. Yes, that's true. Yes, it is true. It is true, but yeah. So the comment is that it disenables generic programming because you can do it for integral constants or for anything else. And yes, that's true. And that's basically where I'm going, actually. The thing is that runtime arithmetic or consexpr arithmetic, because as you can see, this function is consexpr. So runtime or consexpr arithmetic now works just the same because I use the same syntax. So I can write a single function using value syntax, and now I'm able to do it consexpr if you know the implementation allows for it, which it does in this case. And I'm able to do consexpr computations, runtime computations, but also pure type level computations. So this is, I think, a big gain over our initial approach. And so yeah, that's pretty cool. But when you start looking at integral constants as objects, it kind of makes sense suddenly to maybe improve their interface, right? Why not put more stuff in their interface if that's useful? So for example, we could have a member function called times, which just applies a function n times. And then loop unrolling, it used to be like that. And now, right? Or you implement it by hand, or you pray. But now you can just say, hey, well, do this 10 times. Loop unrolling, made easy. And if you're skeptical, here is the assembly that's generated, right? Just the same as if you had written it by hand. This is all just compile time stuff. So we're happy. What if we tried to get a less clunky way to access tuple elements, right? Operator bracket, which is much more natural than using std::get with these damn angly brackets. So of course we cannot pass just like an integer here, because the index we use in std::get has to be a constant expression, and like we saw, argument passing strips away constexpr-ness, so it wouldn't work. But we can pass an integral constant, sure, like this. And so this is how we use to access tuple elements, and this is how it could be, which I think is more natural. And why should we stop here? std::ratio add, or std::ratio divides, and all this std::ratio equal. Such a clunky interface, in my opinion. We could do exactly the same with a better syntax by just revising the interface. Integral integer sequence, same kind of thing. We could maybe have like a bracket operator and similar improvements. Where I want to get at is that if we think out of the box, if we stop looking at compile time stuff as type level stuff, which it isn't, then we open ourselves to much, much more than what we currently have. So that's the philosophy behind this whole paradigm shift. Okay, so this was like an introduction to the philosophy of this paradigm shift using integral constants. Now I'd like to do some kind of type and value unification. I'd like basically to represent types as values. So as we saw, in the context of metaprogramming, they're really just values, right? They're really just like the objects that we manipulate. So I would like to treat them as such. I'd like to have some kind of way to represent my types as objects. And just in the same way, metafunctions are nothing but functions. I'd like to have a way to represent them as actual functions. Of course, I really can't do anything with that at compile time, because I don't have access to the type that's contained in, you know, like that T capital. But it's easy. We can just use templates. And now we're going to have some kind of equivalent to integral constant, except for types. So the philosophy here, that, like, the idea behind this is that we're taking compile time entities, whether they are constexpr integral values or types, and we wrap them into some other thing, container, to be able to represent them as values. This is like the idea behind this thing. So here, T represents the type int in our world, imaginary world. And then, since we have templates, well, we can write meta functions as functions, right? What does that give us? Well, value syntax for type threads. No, I don't, because, sorry, the comment was, don't you need constexpr there? No, I don't. The reason is, it's tricky. See how I take my constref? I am not reading from P, because I'm taking my constref, I don't read from it. If I took my value, I would be copying a non-constexpr value as the argument, and this wouldn't work. But now it does work. So yeah, that's tricky. I didn't think someone would ask.
Just to clarify that, so P here is not constexpr.
Right.
But its pointer of P works anyway because it's, because its pointer is constexpr.
Mm. So what? So the question is, so just to make sure, P is not constexpr, but since its pointer is constexpr, then everything works. Actually, it's more subtle than that. It's really because, well, yes, however, if I had taken by value here in is pointer, okay, instead of by constref or by ref, whatever, it wouldn't work because I would be reading for copying my, you know, type capital object. I would be reading from this non-constexpr object in my static assert, and it wouldn't work. Right? So, you know, should have put maybe constexpr, but I thought I'd just see if people get it. Is it okay with everyone? Yes?
Just to understand, so what you are saying basically is that the compiler reads this call to each point and as constexpr, even though you actually did not.
No, it is.
The argument of, or the parameter, because it's a reference type, it's implicitly constexpr. Passing a reference to the constexpr, passing a value would not be.
So the question is, since the argument here is a reference, is it implicitly constexpr? No, it isn't. If I gave a name to this parameter and then touched that parameter inside this function, like, say, I don't know, just refer to it, it wouldn't work because I would be using this non-constexpr object at compile time, which doesn't work. But now I'm not touching it. It's basically like you can throw in a constexpr function, but like you can have the throw statement, you just must not actually execute it. So I can have something that's not constexpr, I just can't touch it. Okay? Yes?
Essentially, the idea is that you're looking at the type to compute the result, not the value to compute the result.
So the comment is that essentially what I'm doing is I'm looking at the type to compute the result instead of looking at the value to compute the result. And this is absolutely right. This is the idea behind this thing here. It's exactly that, precisely. Let's move on. So variable templates, sugar, we all love sugar. So now, even a bit better. No clunky, you know, curly braces, and just looks better. OK, and what does that give us? A lot of things, actually. But like, types are now first-class citizens. So it's now possible to put types in a tuple, for example. It would be possible to put them in a vector, but it would be pretty useless because vectors are, and I mean std vector, because they are homogeneous containers, right? So you would be basically having like a container of empty, you know, objects that really don't mean anything. But it's useful to have them into tuples, because then you can basically, this is a type list. You know, this is just an equivalent implementation of a type list using value syntax. And for those that might think that it is inconvenient to type make tuple, type int, blah, 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 well, there's this variable template that we could write, tuple t, which basically is equivalent to that. So syntactic overhead, basically zero. Yes?
I kind of disagree with the title of this slide, because I think that for them to be first class citizens, really, they would have to like be able to actually put them in a vector.
OK, so the comment.
So that's like, you could say that for functions, a function pointer is the value of the function, right? So I believe that for a type, the value of the type would be something akin to type input.
So the comment is, he disagrees with the type of with the title of the slide, because for types to be real first class citizens, you'd have to be able to put them in vectors. Well, I kindly disagree, because what is special to std vector? Like, std vector has nothing special. The fact that the quality of being homogeneous does not, like, it is not more important to be able to put things in a vector than to put things in a tuple. Okay. The important thing here is that we can, these are objects, we can copy them around, we can pass them to algorithms, we can do, you know, we can use them as objects. That's the point. But, and you know, okay, I'll just change the title.
But you cannot really say sort them at runtime.
So the comment is that you cannot sort them at runtime. No, of course you cannot.
Yeah,
but
that's kind of my point, because I'd like to be able to do that, and I believe
okay, so I'll answer with, you cannot sort runtime integers at compile time. And so integers are not first class citizens, according to this definition.
No, you are twisting my words.
Okay, let's not get caught into the, you know, okay, so just types are now objects. And now nobody's going to be, you know, this is just true. So okay, and now the full language can be used. So whereas before, if I create an MPL vector, and copy if is basically filter, okay, the filter algorithm. So I filter it with this expression here, which basically says you're going to only keep the types which are pointers or references, okay? And I need to use this kind of small domain-specific language, type-level domain-specific language to create a inline lambda expression. Whereas now, since we are using objects, well, we can just use generic lambdas to manipulate them. So here, the generic lambdas is being passed these guys, which are type capitals. And since we have defined, well, this one wasn't defined here, but you know, we could. So since we have defined our type threats to work on values, we get this natural syntax. And why am I using or underscore here? It's just because this returns a std integral constant in the library. And I cannot overrule the or operator for std integral constant. But I'm working on, you know, I'll basically iterate from std integral constant and return something like that. Yeah?
So can you go back one slide?
Sure.
So it's not quite the same, because this one short circuits.
Short circuits. Oh, OK.
Okay,
yeah, that's true. Okay, so the comment is, it's not the same because the OR short circuits. You are right, perfectly right. Yeah, that's true.
Would logical OR, like double pipe, would that short circuit at compile time if you were able to use it? I guess not. Yeah, never mind.
So the question is, if I was able to use the OR operator instead of this, would that short circuit at compile time? No, because I would have to overload the OR operator, and it would be just a function call just like that. The truth is, in most cases, it doesn't really matter. Like, one could argue that you get some better compile time performance if you do not evaluate this, it's not really true. I mean, like the performance gain that you get from just using this new library is just, you know, way more than just this short circuiting. The only problem is if you have something that might fail here. And I won't present it today, but there's a way to overcome this. I've implemented some kind of a way to do laziness, basically, so you're able to have lazy expressions. Matt, I think you had a.
No, I was just going to say that, but the main reason you want those.
Well. Yeah, OK. Right. So it would be possible, OK? But this is like an intro talk to this new way of thinking, so I'm not going into all the details. But I got discovered. We only need one library. So before, we needed MPL and Fusion. And then sometimes when we needed to, you know, interoperate between those libraries, well, there are ways to interoperate, but it's still not 100% natural. Now, a single library is needed because everything is just values. So let's code to write from the library implementer. A unified syntax means more reuse. We're able to reuse code that we had written before for handling normal values, right, and do it at compile time. So this is a boost proto expression. This is taken actually from Eric Niebler, calc, simple calc or something example from the boost proto library. And this basically creates, well, an expression that I can evaluate, and it's going to, well, compute this, right? And then normally I could just do runtime computations. So I've evaluate my expression with those two arguments, and I could just do it at runtime with runtime values. But now, well, with minor changes, and I mean really minor changes, okay? So the example doesn't work as is, but almost. With minor changes, we're able to evaluate this proto expression at compile time. This is some cool stuff, I think. Yes?
And the minor change you refer to is basically making evaluate const expert, right? Adding some const experts to the
unit. So the question is, and the minor change that I'm referring to here is basically adding const expert. No, it's making sure that my evaluator can have types, can have like the arguments that it sends may have different types. So I can pass integral constants. Actually, this evaluate here, I think it's not even const expert. It doesn't really matter because I'm using the decal type here. See? So it turns out that const expert actually for type level or heterogeneous programming doesn't, like, it's a nice to have, but it doesn't give us any functionality. Like, we can do everything we can do with it, we can also do without. So reusing, proto. More consistency. So here I'm declaring a fusion map. It maps types to values using this syntax. When you first stumble on that, you really have to know what's happening. And then when you want to fetch something into the map, like I showed earlier in the slides, you have to use this syntax here. Whereas now, while it is, I do agree that it is, you know, of course it's bigger, but I also think it's much more clear. So we're just associating, we're just creating a map which associates types to values. And then we use the bracket operator to access our compile time map. Anybody can understand that. If you show that to your coworkers, they're going to be like, oh, OK, I kind of get it. You know? Whereas this might be like, what the? What's that? OK, so let me just check the time. OK, about 35 minutes, good. OK, so we can represent types as values, but we can't really do anything useful with them, because say you have a type represented as a value, and then you do some kind of use computation, and you'd like to declare an object with that type, with the result type. Right now, you can't really do it. You're stuck at the value level. You'd have to like create a function and then use pattern matching to extract the inner type, and it's just dumb. Simply, just use a nested alias and then decal type. So what's going to happen? You have your value level result after this computation here, and then you decal type it. This gives you an object. You know, so decal type of T here is a type capital something. And then you just fetch the colon, the nested alias inside it, and you get your result at the type level. And you can do whatever you want with it. Now, in general, this is a three-step process. So you wrap your raw C++ types into, you know, your value container. And then you perform your computations using this value syntax. And finally, you can unwrap it with decal type, colon, colon type. Now, some people might think this is really cumbersome. I've got some comments on the mailing list. People were kind of worried about, like, hey, if you're going to do this, it's really going to be painful, you know? Especially in dependent contexts where you have to call to say, like, type name, decal type, blah, blah, colon, colon type. Yes? So the question is, can variable templates make this pattern nicer? The answer is no. You have to. What?
Alias template. Yeah,
alias template.
Yeah, same.
Oh, alias templates.
Right.
Oh. No, because you're going from value to type. What would you put in your alias template? You're talking about maybe like an alias template called, say, eval or something, right? Wouldn't work because your alias template must take a type. Okay, so actually it turns out that it's not really cumbersome. First, you only need to do it at thin boundaries. So you first put into the values, you know, the types as values, then you do your big computation, or maybe not that big, but that big. But so you do your type computations using value syntax, and all along the way you're benefiting from all those advantages. And then only at the end do you need to use this. Also, sometimes it's not required. So sometimes you just need to check whether some property about your result is satisfied. And so in that case, you can skip the third step. And in some other cases, like we saw for tuple T, right? When I use tuple T, then you can skip the first step of actually wrapping your types into the type variable template, because you're just putting them into a tuple T. So here's an example of finding the type with the smallest size in a sequence of types. So first, I get a sequence of types, put them in an MPL vector, then find the minimum element with this predicate, which basically says, hey, you give me two types, and I'm going to return whether the first one has a smaller size than the second one. And then this algorithm returns an iterator from the MPL, so I just dereference it. And then here's how I use it. And now, well, notice how I shifted from a struct to a variable template. And now I can compute the minimum using of this sequence here. And this is what I was referring to here. I'm just skipping the first step of this, you know, general process. So I compute the minimum of the sequence with this predicate, which anybody can understand. And size of underscore is just a size of, except it's like the size of operator lifted to values. And then here's the third step. I decal type the thing here, and here's how I can use it. And I'd like to point out that this example is actually like the worst example I could have chosen. And this was actually my point, is that this is a very small computation. And it's a type level computation, pure type level computation. So this is where we would expect our new paradigm to really, really suck, right? We would expect it to be like the cost of this type value conversion is not amortized on a long, you know, piece of code. So if this isn't too bad here, shouldn't be too bad when you get to larger computations. Okay. Now, types are objects, and I really mean in the object-oriented sense. So what would be their interface? It turns out that the interface of a type is exactly typeGet. The question we have to ask us is basically, what does it make sense to do with types? You know, you can add const, you can add pointer, you can check whether it is a reference, stuff like that. And so the object-oriented interface is precisely typeGet. And from that, you can build up larger computations. And it turns out that there is a generic lifting process, which allows taking any meta function or type threat and representing and to represent it as a normal function. Okay, and it's basically the same as when we took const expert integers and we represented them as objects with integral constant. Then we took types and represented them as objects with type capital. And now we can do the same with templates and meta functions. So let's reconsider here. I add this meta function or function, whatever. Could also write it this way, right? Just use to that pointer. Turns out that there is a pattern. Given any number of type arguments and given any meta function here, I can just write I can just abstract this meta function here into a template argument and then just apply this, you know, whatever meta function into the result. So this is what it gives us. A meta function takes an f, which is a template parameter, which is I expect it to be a meta function. Then you give me any number of types, right? And I'm just going to apply this meta function on those types and return the result as a value level type. Is everybody with me? Good. And then I can take any meta function or type threat or whatever you wrote in the MPL days, and just like that, you're getting a value level function. And then sugar, use a variable template to simplify things. Looks cuter. So that's it. Okay. I got a small case study. So this was, of course, inspired by Sebastian's talk. Disclaimer. Oh, yeah.
Two slides back. You have the template parameter.
Yep.
So it said one of your goals of this library is to unify type and value syntax and computation.
Mm-hmm.
What would you do in this situation if your template took a mix of types and values instead of just types?
So the question is, what would I do if my meta function here took a mix of types of type names and non-type template parameters? Wouldn't work. Simply.
We have integral constant, assumed rule constant.
Yeah. So the Marshall says that we have integral constants and bool constants and stuff like that. So yeah. If in metaprogramming we're never ever using non-type template parameters because they're not because it doesn't. Basically because of this problem, actually, is because it doesn't allow us to treat meta functions in a uniform way. So I'm not really too, so I don't have a solution. If you have a meta function that takes like an integer, can do it. But I think it's not really a problem in practice. Okay, so yeah, disclaimer. This is not like the same switch any as Sebastian presented. It's more bare bones, more stupid, but I hacked it away. So anyway, so basically the goal is, given a boost any, we want to switch on the runtime type of this boost any. Okay, and if it's an int, then call this lambda here. If it's a double, then call this lambda here. If it's empty, that is, if like I don't initialize it, then call this lambda here. And if it's none of this, then call this default case here. Yes?
So what does Sebastian's solution have that this does not?
So the question is, what does Sebastian's solution have that I don't? Well, Sebastian's solution, you could with Sebastian's solution, you could just not specify empty, right? And it would just work. It would take like basically it would detect the first lambda that has the lambda that has no that's a null array lambda, and it would just take it to be the empty. And then instead of writing case, you could just write you could just add a lambda here. And also, it would detect the int from the type of the parameter. So, you know, like, there are differences, right? But we don't have like an hour and a half to present it, so it's simpler. And yeah, right. So first, what we're going to do is, when we have a case, we're going to associate a type to a function. And what we're going to do is just return a student make pair, right, a pair that associates the type t to this function f. And then default is simply case. It's simply like associating this dummy type, which I really just used to like detect the fact that this is the default case. And finally, empty is void. So what I'm doing here is basically switch A and then call the result of, and this is unclear for now, I know, but call the result of this call here with a pair type int this lambda, type double this lambda, and so on. Everybody's with me? Good. Now the beast. Okay. This is actually nice because it shows a lot of features of the library. Yes?
Can you have a couple slides back?
How many?
So there it could be generic lambdas, right? You don't have to say int I double D. It could be auto I, auto D.
So the question is, here it could be a generic lambda and you wouldn't have to repeat the types. Yeah, true. Absolutely, yeah. Actually, yeah, I should have written it that way so it's more clear for people. Okay, so switch, you give me a result which defaults to void. It was just because I took your unit test and then I wanted to pass your unit test. So, but we don't really use that, okay, in this example. So given an any, I'm going to return a lambda with just this stuff, okay? And the interest of returning a lambda is simply because it allows me here to write this, to use this like syntactic sugar, which I think looks a bit better than if I add a comma instead. Whatever, you know. Okay, first I take my cases, put them into a tuple. Because tuples, we can manipulate them. Parameter packs, not so well. Then I find the default case, so Hanna find if in the cases, so I search the cases for a case whose first element, because remember, cases are nothing but pairs, are std pairs. So I look for a case whose first element is the type default. Everybody's good? And find if here returns, it doesn't return a value, it actually returns like a compile time optional. Okay? So it's going to be empty, compile time empty, if it doesn't find it, and it's going to contain, you know, the proper case if it does find it. So then I can static assert that it is not nothing, that like this thing here, this optional value is not empty. Because if it is empty, then you forgot your default case, and you should, and it should not compile. Then I get the rest of the cases, all of those cases that are not the default case, basically. By filtering, by keeping only those cases whose type is not the default thing. So this gives me a tuple of all the cases that are not the default one. And then I unpack this sequence here. So I unpack the default case, the non-default cases into this lambda. What does it mean? Unpack takes a sequence and it takes a function and it calls the function with the contents of the sequence. It's basically std apply from the fundamentals TS, except the arguments are flipped. And I think it looks much nicer, by the way, because if the like in the std apply, you expect the function first. So what you end up having is like you have the function and then you have this little comma trailing rest here, and it's really ugly. So I prefer this for that reason. So I call this generic lambda here with this sequence. And then I'm going to call impl with the any, the type of the any, which this is a std type index, type info. And then remember, this is an optional pair. This is an optional case, right? Because I might not have found the default case here. So I just dereference it like we do with optional, okay, and get the second, which is the function inside of it. So this is the function associated to the default case. Is everybody clear with this one, with this part? Good. So let's now see impl. So we're going to process the cases. And yes, we're using variable templates here. Variadic templates. Because I'm not claiming that everything can be handled perfectly through a metaprogramming library. This is not my claim. But it still helps for a lot of things. Right? And I thought about, like, how could I implement this with the library? And I was like, not so clear. And then I just decided that it was easier to do it recursively with variadic templates. There's no perfect approach here. Okay. First, so if I have at least one case here, I'm going to get the type which is associated to that case. Okay? And then if the type of my any here is equal to the type ID of T, so to the current case, I'm going to do this weird thing here, which I'll explain in a second. And otherwise, I just continue with the rest. OK? I'll explain this in a minute. And the base case is when I'm done, when I have no cases except the default one, I just call the default one. What happens here? Well, remember how the empty case is an Eulery lambda, whereas the other ones expect something, an argument. I cannot call when I'm on the empty case. So when I have the like case void, because this associates like this lambda to the type void. So when I get the type void, I cannot call it with an argument because, well, the lambda doesn't expect one. So what I do, if T here is void, then I return this function here, this if underscore, returns this lambda. Otherwise, it returns this lambda. In all cases, I just call the resulting lambda with these arguments. Good? And what this does is, so if it's void, it just calls it with no argument. And otherwise, it calls it with the any cast to the right type. And the reason why I do this instead of writing just a normal if is because this wouldn't compile. I need the case here and actually the any to. So here I need the case to be dependent. Because if I'm not in the empty case, I cannot, like, this expression is not well formed, so it's not going to compile. So it must not be compiled. It must not even be like instantiated. And so, I mean, like, the body of this lambda must not be instantiated otherwise. So I make the case underscore dependent by getting it as an argument. And same here. Actually, I don't care whether case is dependent, but what I need is A here to be dependent, because if T is void, I cannot do boost unsafe any cast to void. So by making A here dependent, this whole body here is not instantiated until this is actually called. And since it's only called in one case, in the right case, well, everything works. Is everybody following me? Yes?
So the code could be a little bit more clear. You don't use the same case underscore name in the inside lambda as well as outside.
So the point was made that the code could be more clear if I didn't use the same case underscore outside and inside the lambda. True. Yeah, my bad, I guess. So is everybody with me? Good. And so base case, we saw it. And it turns out that this is about 70 lines of code. And I think for the most part, your coworkers could kind of understand the, you know, the kind of.
Sort of.
Yeah. Okay. So concretely, you know, I've been talking about this paradigm shift and how it's, I think it's better, how I think it's the future, and so on. concretely, what do I propose? Concretely, what I propose is a library called HANA. It's a library which handles heterogeneous and type-level computations using the paradigm that I've just presented. It has more than 75 algorithms. Just for the record, Fusion has about 50 algorithms. So it's like there's a lot in there. It provides 8 different heterogeneous containers, 3 of which are really the core containers, tuple, map, and this compile time optional that we saw. There's also like a compile time range, which is basically a better stood integer sequence. And there's like a compile time variant and other stuff like that, right? Compile time set. But the most useful are those three. The compile times are guaranteed to be better than with the MPL and much, much better than with Fusion. Otherwise, fill in the bug report. Regarding runtime performance, it's, well, you know, for type-level computations, it's basically zero overhead because it's only compile-time stuff. And for heterogeneous computations, it's guaranteed to be at least as good as Fusion. Otherwise, you fill in the bug report. It works on C++ 14 compilers, on bugless C++ 14 compilers. So Clang 3.5 and up, tested on every commit. And GCC 5, I'm working on it. Think it might have to wait for 5.1, depending on how responsive to my bug reports the GCC guys are. Yes? So
what is the feature that's lacking in buggy compilers?
So the question is, what are the features that are lacking in the buggy compilers? Basically, if you try, OK, in GCC 5, if you, you know, GCC 5 has all C++ 14. But if you try to, if you have a variable template, which is, say, a function object, and try to call it, it's going to give you a linker error in GCC 5, which is just weird. But I'm trying to work around this. And other, you know, minor bugs, but this is like the most annoying. OK, and the best of all this is it's going to be available in your next boost release. Probably. Actually, the formal review is scheduled for June 10 to June 24. We're almost there. And depending on the results of this formal review, the library will either be included in Boost or not. So I would invite you, if you have some interest into this kind of stuff, I would invite you to go get the library, try it. It's really easy to set up, right? Especially, well, on Clang. And then fill in bug reports, pull requests if you want. Give me your comments. I need that to improve the library, right? This is the reason why I've been doing this for the past 2 years. I'm trying to solve the problem of metaprogramming in C++. I think I found the solution. I need the community to give me feedback so I can improve the solution and really pin that problem down. Okay, like we can solve this problem properly once and for all, eventually settle on a solution that can be standardized. And this is, I think, the first step towards this. And please do participate in the formal review if you have the time to and the interest. And so to finish up, I would like to encourage you to embrace the future, to embrace C++ 14, to embrace all these new techniques and this new way of seeing things, right? I think I was able to demonstrate that we can really simplify our lives by just thinking a bit out of the box. And most importantly, I would invite you to embrace HANA and this new metaprogramming paradigm that I've presented. Thank you. So I'll be taking questions, but before I do, I'd like to give very special thanks to the Boost steering committee, because this work was actually funded by the Boost steering committee as an extension to my Google Summer of Code project of last year. And so I would like to thank them very much, because you know, without this, I think it would have been much harder. And the other thing is, I would like to thank Niall Douglas. Is he there? He's not, okay. But I would like to thank him because he's the Google Summer of Code admin for Boost, and he's done a lot for me. Basically allowed me to do Summer of Code for last year. So thanks to these people. Questions? Yes?
So what does HANA stand for?
Oh, so the question is, what does HANA stand for? Basically, I needed a not too long name that was that looked OK. And so I settled up on HANA. And then I tried to put some meaning on it. And so yeah, I kind of failed. But you know, OK, so I could say that it stands for heterogeneous combinators, but it's not really. So yeah, basically, it's just a name like that you'll remember, right? OK, well, thank you.